shoot air, hit air. Yep. Strategy. Yeah, I don't blame people trapping heavy train as we see a tiny IO pick coming out for Team Bad English. You know, everyone's on those you know, feel good memories of Team Kaipi, and they want to power fret some team with the power pressure from OG is abandoned, and everyone's, you know, feels bad, man.
Here we are. That is definitely true. Kaipi, well, maybe that's the kind of they're playing a lot actually recently in these tier 2 tournaments, so to speak. They've been very busy recently in a bunch of things. Not just the Worldplay Invitational, WCA is a big one that they've been involved in, Pro Dota Cup, all that jazz. So maybe they're getting back to that place. I mean, they definitely have the talent between them.
Yeah, I think they can if they just get their turn of them and then have their synergy. They can definitely make some waves. I don't know how far they can go out of the competition for a while, but so it's Sing Sing in the tier 1, but I think with some practice they might be able to, you know, maybe black horse a couple tournaments here and there, at least get some good placements in tier 1 tournament. But coming up for the bans, TVE bans out the Tirsal and the Void, pretty good bans out for the IO Tiny, both strength heroes, and Tirsal does eat little balls of light for Brock. Coming up for the bans for Kaipi, there's a Batrider and a Huskar. I don't know, maybe it's just a playstyle. Huskar is pretty hard to deal with when you have the IO, and the Batrider is a good game partner with the Tiny, IO Tiny.
Yeah. Huskar is just one of these heroes that you don't really want sneaking up on you. I mean, especially if you already have a hero like an IO in the pool, or on the field, I should say, who can be that extra boost that Huskar needs these days, ever since the nerf especially. Just keep him alive and be that monster that he can be if he stays at low health for a long period of time. But yeah, you just don't want to get cheesed by that if you can help it, so you just ban it now. No big deal there. And TBE take up the Ogre Magi, which is actually quite great here. They have a bit of a buff strat going on, not just with the Ire Overcharge, but also with the Bloodlust, which is the build these days for most Ogres, on top of that Tiny, which can be quite dangerous here, if you consider how much damage he actually accumulates just naturally off of his ultimate.
Yeah, KP is definitely preparing for this Ire. They already picked up the other Titan and the Marauder, together. They are very work pretty well together. But in this case, they also pick up the Witch Doctor, which, you know, IO and Tiny are going to be holding hands for most of the game, so good. Pick up against both of them. Witch Doctor is a heal, cancels out a good amount of damage from the Open Knight, which is damaging ability. You guys remember? Once wondering if you're going to max Fire Blast or Ignite, please max Ignite, because that does more damage. Early game. Sorry, I get triggered. Fire Blast in my pubs.
PTSD coming out there, but yeah, it's...
PTSD. But yeah, this is, so Team Betting, I guess, would be their Batrider replacement of the Clockwork. They need some hero to get in and start the fight with for the Tiny IO relocate. Ideally, you do not want your Tiny IO to be initiating the fight. You want somebody else to up or start the fight, you know, contention somewhere. That way when the, you know, big ping area comes in, IO relocate, they might be at the mini map distracting with either the Batrider, Lasso, or in this case lots of disruption coming up from Team Mighty English across the map.
Yeah, definitely gonna need some of that, especially considering the amount of channel spells that Kaipi already have between the Witch Doctor and the Elder Titan Stomp as well.
Oh yeah, for sure. That's,
having the Clockwork really available good. It's actually the one thing that makes Clockwork a good and viable pick in this game for me, because normally you look at him and see, we don't really see him all that often.
Yeah,
the reason is that the issue with Clockwork is he needs to be able to make something happen. Right. He's no fallback. He cannot really farm the jungle. He needs to find kills, and he needs to find the levels in the offlane. He's also not the best Iron Talon jungler, so he's in a bit of an iffy position, to a point where if you don't get anything done with him, then he's almost a dead hero, right? Whereas most other heroes that you would like to see in the offlane have some sort of fallback, one way or another. But in this game, Just with the battery assault being potentially very effective, and just with the IO Tiny always being able to follow up on any sort of initiation with the relocate on top, right on top of the clockwork. I think you shore off some of these shortcomings quite a bit with that hero.
Yeah, you definitely see those the more of the trend for offlaners that they need a farming mechanic, whether it's Beastmaster with Iron Talent and Boars, or Batrider with Glass with his Firefly, or Sand King with his custom finality. They always have like a way to farm back into the game. You see these, everyone's farming evenly across the team, especially the offlane. Clockwork is remaining. If he gets zoned out this game, this could. But Axe picked for IP. I like the idea of what they're going for. They needed a frontliner that can soak up damage while Potom and Witch Doctor can play out their damage from the backlines. They might have preferred Hunter, maybe, but I understand they're just somebody who can be in the front. They might have wanted a little bit more AoE, but Axe, I guess they, playing it? Carry.
Huh? Yeah, it could be. Yeah. I mean, they're actually very confident. They haven't even used all their bonus time with that last pick coming out very quickly, so they know what they want to do, but I was just going to bring up, hey, is it going to be a one-position X perhaps, or is it going to be an offline X, which is kind of the more standard way to go, but with this kind of lineup with the Murano on the field, you have always some semblance, some sort of flexibility.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they have a very kind of a couple of of heroes. I would expect X to get a 4-step this game, but Weaver is going to be hard to lock down. Murano's going to be a little bit difficult to lock down as well. She has her own skill. The Weaver thing, I understand why they're going for here. He's very elusive. He's able to get on the IO and just blow him up so that way you take Tiny, or at least one of his buffs, who would have the overmatch out with him. I think some other heroes that could have worked also in the Weaver's place might have been the hero like Klinks, perhaps, or maybe a Juggernaut. That Juggernaut was not banned, so Juggernaut could also here, but Weaver fits this quite well. They have a nice combination of minus armor for the Witch Doctor, ulti, Adler Trident Aura for Murana the Starstorms, and stuff. They have a good mixes of magical and physical damage. I worry about their burst in the early game. They do lack some burst outside of Starstorm right now. While Team Bat English has, good burst and sustained damage.
Yep.
So if Team Bad English could get off to a good start and get some pickoffs here and there, then it could roll for them pretty nicely. And they're going to pick up Vipers versus... I like
speaking of good start, there it is.
Yeah.
That's a lane dominated and a half here for the middle lane, so Sing Sing, if he ends up being there, he's not going to have a fun time on the Murana for the most part.
He's not going to have a good time.
For the old Titan. Yeah.
Yeah, this is the problem. You're going to pick up this Vipers range hero. One, he's ranged, so it's going to be difficult to bring him down already. But two, he's a Viper. And I already mentioned that if he lacks burst damage, they don't combo. They have to, I guess, being level, I guess, between maybe 10 minutes to 15 minutes, or maybe by 20 minutes they'll have their items and whatnot if everything goes normal. But that, that 5 to 15 minute period, they might lack damage to kill remaining. Their targets. Pretty tanky, he's gonna have IO next to him. Ogre Magi, freaking forehead, 8 armor. Clockwork has his escapes, yep. And Viper is, the flying artillery poison. So how are you gonna kill him? So they're gonna really need, Kaipe gonna really need to coordinate their gank efforts here.
Oh yeah, especially if, especially going into that mid-game phase, considering the itemization these people may go for. I mean, can make a case for a mechanism on the Wisp, but the Viper is also one that likes to pick it up just for the armor and the regen that he has for himself. But no matter who picks it up, together with the Tether, you just maximize the effectiveness of that. And yeah, at that point, Tiny will also probably have a Blink Dagger or something like that to just make sure that he can get in range for his own burst combo. Yeah, there's a lot of potential for TBE to just explode at that point before Kaipe is really ready, but we'll find out if that works out for them.
Seconds to battle. Thank you. The battle begins.
What?
The prize is mine.
Yep. Alright, so with that, we take a quick look at our complete lineups before the action really starts to get going. Starting with Kaipe here in the bottom lane, we've got Bone 7 on the Weaver. It's going to be helped out by Pilai Dai on his own Witch Doctor, one of his favorite heroes here, at least when it comes to competitive play. Sing Sing on the Mirana in mid, his signature hero as well. We've got 33, also known as the Kun, playing the Axe. And in the Dai side jungle, trying to run interference with Sexy Bamboo on the Elder Titan. Now facing them on the Dai side, it's going to be Team Bad English with Tiny making his way back towards the middle lane now, played by Zoo. He's joining up Messi, the Ball of Light, playing the Io. Up top, we've got Cat 3X on the Ogre Magi. Safe lane, a Viper actually for Gadrox. And in the bottom lane, Pwn on the Clockwork. So, yeah, what do you think about this laning actually? Just, I mean, Io Tiny mid, there's no problem with that, but is that the battle lane if you switched it around with the Viper? Oh, bottom lane. Pwn, he's gonna take out the Melodic, unless he just maybe tries to pop himself. He is trying to. They'll keep him alive, but only barely. Damn. Level 2 already. Yep. And with the Axe in jungle, it also means that these two lanes, those are two lanes that should go in favor of TBE, which is extremely necessary considering that this bottom lane has a clockwork. We talked about it, or we touched on it in a draft. It doesn't really have the best tools in off laner here in this meta. We already saw that he almost got killed here as he was zoned out, so he's probably going to have a slower start, especially if you compare that to the Axe. It's kind of pretty much a nominal 3 position here. Starting off straight up in the jungle with the Iron Talon, so he's already level 3.5, he's gonna hit level 5, level 6 by 5-6 minutes as well. Clockwork can only treat him with this kind of timing. Alright, just Bone 7 inside the car, see, we'll get mana burned once, but the box is on him. We'll take a lot of harassment off of that extra minus armor and the right clicks. Weaver is so hard to deal with, especially as a melee hero. Ah, double pulls, double stacks, nice. Wait, what? He pulled the wave? Nice. Okay, he made me miss first blood, but Bone 7 also goes down inside, I guess it gets caught inside the cogs. So going in that deep, perhaps a bit of misplay, not really, it's to be expected. But hey, he got the first blood, he got the advantage in that. Yeah. Alright, 3 kills in game, already missed 2 of them, so that's a great start. Yeah, it's your fault. I'm just gonna blame you the entire game, it's fine. Stomp comes out onto Gadrox, not a whole lot of Sexy Bamboo can do, but at the very least he's getting his levels as well. Just choking as much as he can up in the offlane. Dying once is okay for the most part, especially if it's not the first blood. If he dies another time, then you may have to consider trying to make something else happen elsewhere on the map, but for now, yeah, he's just trying to interrupt, trying to soak up as much as he can. So yeah. Not all that well. 8 and 4 towards the 17 and 5. Also, exactly. How do you do this anyway? I mean, did you just tether to an illusion or what? How do you do this mid-pull? Yeah. I think it's a little bit easier on the Radiant side. It's where I've seen it. I didn't actually realize it could also do it on the die side like that, because terrain is a little bit more less forgiving, I should say. Yeah, they force out a... Yeah. They exchange a little bit of damage here, force out rotation from the Ogre Magi to help out Pwns, who's... still struggling, but he has managed to get to his level 5.5, so he's getting to the point where he has a switch shot available and can start making something happen. He did go for the Rocket Flare build, though. So... maybe looking to try and help out elsewhere on the map without having that big ganking utility with the Battery Assault. Yeah, that's true. Okay, this could turn into something here. Smoke up between Pilot Dying 33. No Blink Digger just yet on the axe. Looks like they're setting up on the high ground, waiting for the Wisp to come up there. Stack up some jungle camps again, or maybe just go into mid lane after the Stomp setup here. Messi follow with the arrow. Zug also gets cast down. That's a beautiful setup here. Dunk one, they don't quite get the dunk on two. Zug gets out of range, but damage over time should finish him off. Not before it gets an avalanche charge, though. An avalanche at the very least off. 2-for-2 trade so far with the rotations coming in, but Weaver, yeah, doing a lot of damage here. The Bucks still on Gadrox. Well, a couple of Reiklings shoot to the trigger, especially within the cast. Bounces back to Cat 3x. This might be a fourth one going down with a little bit of extra help with the right click and the Maledict, ensuring the triple kill for the Witch Doctor. Absolutely. Was a really tough position for CB to be in. I mean, they had the Wisp card with the Stomp into the arrow, which is kind of a really easy combo to land. Well, pretty much if you land the sleep, then you can land the arrow easy as that. But then Zoo got closer here trying to protect his Wisp, but then they didn't account for Pilot Eye coming back in with the cast, kind of locking them down even further into the axe as well. It's kind of a miracle that Zoo actually got an avalanche off in the first place. I think without that, then Kaipi wouldn't have taken any casualties at all. Cat3x, gotta be careful. Sing Sing making the rotation as well. They lead off with the cast, and now Cat3x is in a really tough position. Easy stomp, don't even need the arrow, just right click him down. I guess tanked again, kinda know. Yeah.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Radiant structures are fortified.
Yep. Well, at the very least, it was only an Ogre. Zoo dodges a stomp. Should be fine unless, well, they run three heroes in. They're relatively fast, but defensive relocate use just to heal them back up. Well, then a decent position, but okay, nice little stomp. They only bring Messi back. Stomp into the arrow, that IO is dead. And let's want to try and turn this around. Too much damage being done, but now with the death ward finishing Melva now. This first clock hookshot of the game, Pilot Eye gets caught and will be brought down in return. 1-for-1 trade so far. Eventually, please. No, he survives! Never mind, toss comes out. Thank you, Zoo, for saving my prediction. that was too close though. That was way too close. That was Max Battery Assault, and that would have been much swifter, but, well, it's Max Rocket Flare, not as quick. in the solo kill department here for Pawn. Yep.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Dire's top tower is under attack.
Okay. That's something that'll happen here. 3 points up into a swarm, easy game. But now, bottom lane, Gadrock caught with a stomp, and so the cat's bouncing back towards him into 33's call. He has a Vanguard, so very, very hard to deal with still. Plus, the 2 points up in Corrosive Skin, saving him from magic damage. It's not quite enough to bring him down, just TP's out into the trees. No further lockdown available to cancel that. So, yeah, I was gonna ask you about the Vanguard build up on the Viper, but I guess if you want to be the tank role, that's the way to go, isn't it? Yeah, I mean.
Dire's middle tower is under attack. Dire's structures are fortified.
Yeah, it's why would you? You get free maximum speed. No, yeah, it's like building a blink on anti-mage, right? Oh, relocate comes out into the middle lane here. Zoo shows off the blink dagger, tossed back onto the wisp. Sing Sing in a world of hurt. Ghostbuilder comes in here. Messing will not get caught by that. Only Gadrock snapping him back, but it only almost does more damage to Sexy Bamboo. Oh, that hook shot almost catches him, but just short of the range. Could have been an extra kill coming their way. But finishing off Sing Sing Mirana here in this middle lane with showing off the blink. Exactly what you want to do after you just got an item like this and top. Bone 7, it's looking for the Ogre with the bugs nibbling away at him. He isn't all that tanky, yeah. No help coming his way, so Cat3x is actually freaking dead. He got rid of the bug though. But yeah, he's just being run down. Speaking of Blink Daggers, there's one for Axe now as well.
Dire's structures are fortified. Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Top tower.
Opponent stomp into arrow again. A bit of extra damage that'll happen with the Star Storm. Gets off a couple of spells, but ultimately not enough to save his life. TP comes in now from Zoo, finds a combo, three people. Not quite enough to burst anyone down just yet though. You know, it's a 4-4. Everyone's in this. Now the Death Ward comes out. Pilot die low, but not low enough. Can't even get the stomp off. Can't even get the stun off thanks to the stomp in 33 now with the counter initiation of Messing Gadrox here. That's a dunk down on the Wisp. Spears already down. Gadrox, the fourth one on the list. Tanky, yes, but not tanky enough. Double kill for the Coon. Pilot Eye still somehow surviving. The only casualty on the side of KP was Elder Titan, who set this whole thing up beautifully with not one but two stomps. Two crucial stomps. Oh, the hookshot now to Bone 70. Look, it was looking for Pilot Eye. Was still sitting very low, and yeah, a lot of damage being done. Damage over time, Maledict also gonna be amplified now. He's gonna drop very, very low to this. Barely 60 health points down from 1,000. That's nasty. I bet I, yeah. Well, silver lining is that TB have been very diligent about their stacks. Zoo and Messi, they've been farming them up quite nicely, so the Tiny's still getting some semblance of farm, right? He's just got a Blink Dagger, already has the Orbit Club on top of that as well. 600 gold, so he's sitting on top of his team's net worth chart. The problem is, the Weaver's slightly ahead. And we talked about how he has a harder time, or his impact is generally later. That's even truer with Ode of Defiance build, isn't it? Because it's not exactly an aggressive item.
Dire's structures are fortified. Radiant's top tower is under attack.
I'll take that.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack. Dire's bottom tower is under attack. Under attack.
Yep.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. It allows them to take these kind of fights instead of just take these fights a little bit more aggressively as well in that sense. Because you have to worry a bit less about the damage that TB has and can go in a little bit deeper instead of just sitting on the outskirts as weavers normally tend to do if they go for this kind of glass cannon straight up desolator buildup. Yeah, not against a burst damage of tiny, I guess. That's probably the biggest issue for them.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Yep. Oh, call on to Zoo. There it is. Unless Shadow comes out now, looks like TB want to fight this. Messi and Zoo already back in before the relocate can't even come back. But KaiP, they're setting up on the high ground. They have that vision advantage now, looking for a stomp. Will not quite catch anybody. Both teams just jockeying for position here, trying to get rid of the creep wave. Just make sure that the style push is not happening. It looks like KaiP. Yeah. It's not just the Wisp balls, it's also the Rocket Flare who is super, super useful in these kind of situations. You can maybe scan if you have that available, but you can also confirm that every single time with the Rocket Flare. Now the hookshot comes in, finds Sexy Bamboo, the arrow to counter this out though. Sexy Bamboo, well, not a whole lot he can do as long as he stands in there, but he manages to make his way through. Combo here on 33, not quite enough to bring him down, but will die a couple of seconds later. Bone 7 trying to go for the Wisp here now, so he uses the time lapse. He's been focused down. Gadrox is taking a lot of damage here from the Death Ward with the back nibbling away. Then Sing Sing comes in with a Star Stomp to finish him off. So it's a 2 for 2 trade so far. So I didn't manage to bring down Bone 7, but now Pilot Eye gets one of the cask. Messi, he's actually slept up. He cannot help us Tiny out. Damage out from Sing Sing and Sexy Bamboo. Just too much for these two supports that are left to handle for TB. God, the stomp comes out. There's an arrow to follow. Catherix is actually dead here on top of that as well. Unless Messi can help him out. Nice little relocate again. Keeping him alive just barely. And now, Pwn coming back. No Agnum Scepter or anything like that, so doesn't have the hookshot available right away again. But it's coming back in a couple of seconds. Not gonna go for it though. Speaking of Zoo, there it is. That is a combo. Yeah. Plus the Rocket Flare to help finish it off, so yeah. That was a nice little pickoff. These kind of things can help TB to stabilize a little bit more, right? Keep control back, at least their own side of the map. If you look at the vision now, not too much on the side of the Radiant here. They've got one deep ward here in the bottom lane. But the vision for TBE looks even worse. We'll try and get some more intelligence and maybe an extra pickoff here on the back of the smoke in the bottom lane. Pwn also with a hookshot available again, waiting for someone to show themselves in the mid lane. KaiP, they're a bit grouped up. Not quite be spotted out by that spotted rocket flare. We'll find who first here. It's a big question. As KaiP also now smoked up, looking towards the top lane. It's gonna be Gadrox, not an easy target to bring down. But he's all alone. Definitely possible. Now Moonlight Shadow, Bone 7 showing himself first. Gadrox already with a retreat, will not get caught out.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Radiant structures are fortified.
Right.
Boom! There he
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Radiant's bottom tower has fallen.
Yep. Kaipi, this being a map awareness, gonna look to bring down some more aggressive wards. He's trying to take control of that jungle.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Interesting. It has the crystals on the way now. And they're looking for something here. Zoon frontlines, but there's a sentry. Little do they know, Axe comes in, so they get the call out. Messy caught in there too. That should be a dunk, especially with Stump coming in. 33 will be some life out home. Nice little rush, and did not quite catch Pilot Die though. Still chanting in the death ward. Doing a lot of damage to Gadrox, but that's still a tanky, tanky Viper. But the big burst combo already down for TBE, so Kaipi can feel comfortable continuing this chase with Bone 7, Sing Sing, and Pilot Die. The arrow will not. Oh, barely. Barely misses Pwn there as he almost walks back into it. It's just Kaipi asserting dominance here right now, isn't it? Catch him, he's inside the Cox as well. Trying to make his way out, gets caught with a bit of a mana burn. Almost enough to bring it down. I think it would have been a big one. Well, I mean, Kaipi isn't actually that far ahead if you look at the grass. Only about 1,000, 1,500 gold, 2,500 experience. But they're playing like they're like 5, 6, 7k ahead right now. Is this just the nature of their lineup at this stage in the game? Or why do you think that is? Oh, that thought, messy. Cast into arrow, this should be a free pickup unless Zoo can turn us around here. Messi should might be still taking out to Meldic, but at what cost? Sexy Bamboo caught with a clockwork again. They also have the sentries to make that work, so they bring him and Pylite down. Great baits here, Io still gives up his own life, but hey, definitely worth it. I'm sorry. He just picked up the Agon Scepter though, so with all the buffs that he has, you don't really care too much about the attack speed difference that you get with that. And he's gonna hit for a ton now, plus Cleave, especially once he hits level 16, also very close to that. So that timing window is all about the burst is about to end. Just blink back here as the calf came flying in. Could have been a big pickoff here with the entirety of Kaipi's lineups setting themselves up down here in the bottom lane.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack. Dire's structures are fortified. Yep.
I'm feeling confident to siege away this tower. TBE not quite ready to engage.
Dire's bottom tower has fallen.
Yeah, I'm just gonna let him go. Is it really worth it trying to defend this tier 2 tower even? I mean, they kinda had all the spells available. Yeah. Kinda need to have a way to make sure to keep an eye on Pilot Die, have something available to cancel that death ward, because it's been continuing to be an issue for them as well. plus the X-Count initiations, yeah. Oh, Zoo. She got called by the cast, yet it bounces to the Ancients, fortunately. And he's 33, gets the call off, so Zoo just cancels his TP, gets, resigns to his fate, essentially. He's trying to make a trade happen. Five people running, might actually get a kill here with another toss, but doesn't actually find it. Everyone's so low off just fighting a single Tiny, though, that's kind of ridiculous. Yeah. Selfish. Just imagine if he had help there. Holy hell. Huh? Yep. Well, just goes to show the Kaipi still have to be careful about how they take these kind of engagements going forward. That's still gonna be in TPE to execute as well to make sure that they don't run into Kaipi's lineup here. I mean, don't get caught out by Storms, if at all possible. So, how big is Roshan, or how big of a role is Roshan gonna play going forward? I mean, both teams kinda have the tools to deal with it, just with the mass amounts of physical damage on one side and a bit of minus armor on the other. TBE, and yeah, actually split up a little bit. The Stomp will miss. We'll let Shadow after the smoke here, which will Kaipi just trying to find a way in. Sentries are around. Gedrox in the front lines, still very, very hard to actually initiate on. The arrow will be dodged, a hook shot as well. Pwn makes his presence known up on the high ground. He'll still find Sexy Bambo. Now he, all of a sudden he's the one kind of isolated. Gets a stomp off on Gedrox, but Pwn comes in, just walks in from the side. He stuffs it up. Now the calls to save him. 33 pile die with a cast. Only bounces once. Now the arrow will be dodged with a blink from Zoo as he comes in for Pilar. Dice swaps him down with a big old tree. Now 33 also. Next one on the list. Trying to survive. Trying to one out with the extra armor. And TBE unwilling to overcommit into this here. Especially with a buyback from Pilar Die. Kaipi can still take a fight. Unless they lose Bone 7, which is exactly what they do. I'm not sure what he was trying to do. I mean, he should have figured that TBE are no, are no cheapskates when it comes to sentries. With that, they're looking for more. The arrow once again will miss. Barely Pwn just dodging them left, right, and center. But this cask will be enough to bring it down in the end.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Yep.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Yeah, just some meta positioning there for TBE, yeah, I wanna say, because the only one that was really exposed was Gedrox here up on the high grounds. And if he gets gone on with the Vanguard with Dragon Eyes, he's sitting at 2.2k health points. There's plenty of time for TBE to react to that, so naturally Kaipi would be thinking twice about that, whereas they then found themselves in a position where they've got the Elder Titan pretty much alone here on the high ground in the Radiant side jungle, half of the team on the other side. And yeah. What? Oh, okay. Relocate, nicely done. There's still Invis here, Bone 7 looking for more. There's still 4 heroes around. It was not a long TP, but now it's down to 33, prevents him from actually getting too many extra right clicks off. Nice little Earth Splitter, enough to bring down Pwn, especially with an extra dunk. Now Zoo, dropping low, but Messi still able to keep himself alive barely, despite the back nibbling weight him. Tethering back to Zoo, and looking for him to kill his oppressor. The Bone 7 dies again. Sexy Bambo, the stumble barely actually miss. That's a 4-for-1 trade in the end. Sing Sing only barely able to get out after all of this. What is going on here, DFB? That's a good question here. Well, he might find some extra now. Actually lands an arrow onto Pwn, the Sylveon with a double star. So I'm not quite as potent though, so Pwn will not instantly be brought down. Will require help from Pilot 933 to actually finish him off. But hey, kill's a kill. Exactly what they need to kind of once again stabilize their own game plan now. Yeah, feels bad, man. Well, he's still only like 350 gold away. It's not too big of a deal. Once he has that, then this... Yeah. Just buys himself another couple of minutes before that comes online, and... This Aghanim Scepter for Clockwork is one of these items that has potential to change the game if he's good enough in using them multiple of those in a fight, and... It's definitely gonna have the chance to, considering, as we're talking about, that everyone's kinda tanky. So these fights should naturally take a little bit longer than it normally would. Cat reacts, also a bit of a rough position, gets caught with a melding, but he's a tanky ogre, gets some help from Messi relocating in. Now the hook shot here onto Pilot Die, nicely done. The arrow comes in, but the damage is still being done with a battery assault and a whisper is bouncing through. Should be able to bring him down with one more fire blast. Io actually the one claiming credit for the kill. Yeah, all of a sudden 200 gold away from that axe still, despite the death. Well, there's the force of an Ogre Magi, so maybe that's kind of yeah. The more the better, obviously, but at least they have one to kind of try and at least get the minimum amount of utility that they need. Gadrox up top. Relocate comes in though. Into the back lines here. They're looking to try and burst down as one of these supports. Miss a bit of the combo, but still get Pilot Eye. And up a little bit further, the Elder Titan. Now it's Kaibi on the hard dart. Nice little hook shot here between the lines on Bone 7. But Io actually takes Clockwork away. Just leaves Zoo to be the sole carry up top. I guess with Gadrox also wrecking away. Cat3x will die to Bone 7 as he is able to skid away to the side, but not sure if TB care too much about this. Brought a couple of heroes down the bottom lane with the relocate back at the very least. Messi and Pwn can provide some sort of damage to tier 2, but now Bone 7 will TP looking for the IO that's also very, very low. Will be able to bring it down. Now it's Pwn all alone. He can't get to a creep perhaps. Now Bone 7, beautiful positioning. Gets him on the edge, short range arrow to cancel TP. The buyback though, forced out, it's top lane, yeah, okay, it's... You win a team fight, you bring down towers, it's not just the nature of a tiny lineup, but he gets hit by the stomp, gets hit by that Earth Splitter, will be dunked down, so TBE overstaying the welcome, Gadrox, only one able to actually get out, Zoo comes back with the Aegis. The arrow comes in, on the death ward still going. So he will fall a second time. Gadrox able to survive, but he's the last man standing after this overcommitment. But hey, it wasn't an overcommitment though. They got the Rax.
capital.
Yes, yeah, so now, as I said, in the form of a desolator. And a DD rune, hello. This could be an avenue for Kaipi to take a team fight with amount of damage up on the TB you might not necessarily expect. Cat3x, see him when the Cheddar comes out, get rocks. Well, they have a gem between them, so they see everything that's going on, relocate on top of the hookshot. A lot of burst damage being done by Sing Sing, and the combo does not actually quite land, as Kaipi are able to split away from each other. No casualties just yet, but Messi and Paul starting to drop very low and relocate back out, making sure that the stomp misses. Another hookshot in on Sexy Bamboo, just keeping low, keeping him out of the fight. I will end up falling to Bone 7, so tracks them down on the high ground as the rest of TBE managed to make their way out. So all things considered, could have been worse for TBE. Losing IO at this stage, not the biggest deal. Oh, Bone 7 though, he's sitting on the low ground, he's zoomed with a completed combo, but not enough to stop him from getting the time lapse off. Now to turn around with a cast, with a death ward, and the box, everything being dumped on TBE, and Gadrox, well, he's tanky with the Crimson Guard now, hookshot in from Bone. He might be able to survive, Sing Sing, not so lucky. But Bone, well, he'll give his own life for it. Once again, 4-for-1 trade, they get Sing Sing, Gadrox survives just because he... the kind of itemization that he has at this point, but he's unable to really secure the tower on the back of that. Dire's middle tower has fallen. Is TBE giving up too much now? I mean, it's... yep. Maybe they're also taking risks that they... yeah. Maybe they're also taking risks that they don't need to take. I mean, that initiation of Bone 7 is kind of an opportunity on a silver platter. I mean, I understand why they took it. They almost brought him down. He barely got the time lapse off for like 10, 20 health points available. And then the stun came out from the ogre after that. If he didn't survive there, yeah, even then X gets a call on Pilot and Cask on top of the Death Ward, which is still level 2, no Agnum Sept or anything, but still does a lot of damage on top of the Maledict and everything else, so it's... exactly. Yeah. Boom. Yep. Well, Roshan not quite back yet, we'll need another minute or so. Sing Sing is shooting in our range just to scout it out. TB not out of it yet, but they've lost a lot of the advantage that they built themselves up. At the very least, they still got the top lane sort of pushing in here with that melee Rax, but it's not gonna save them the game if they keep leading heroes to Kaipi. And now they're looking for the mid lane Zoo. Better get out of there. Looks like TB knows something's up. Oh, Messi, wow. What was he doing there? Baiting out, I suppose, but Pwn coming in? Not a good place to be. Force them out from both sides. Pwn with a melting top and took some extra damage from the Death Orb, but she should be able to survive this. Yeah. No, oh man. Let's check this, let's check the spot for wards. Do they have their own gem at this point? Wipe hazard, yeah, but Kaipi doesn't. This is Roshan fall very, very quickly. Cat3x, alright. I'm not sure what that was about. Force us in a really tough position. Pwn hookshots onto the freaking spirit. Thanks, Volvo. Well, the ogre's not long for the worlds. I don't know what that. Is TB panicking again? Because. I don't know. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Paladai is dead. Nice little freebie here. Now look, also looking for sexy Bamba. Still have the gem on the Viper and the call from 33 here. Hookshot in from Bone 7, just onto Bone 7, just preventing him from getting some extra damage out. Zoo pops his BKB, just turns it around, chopping away with this big old tree of his. Bone 7 needs to be resolving some extra damage. They already used the time lapse earlier. That hookshot will miss. Now the E-Blade will be dodged when the Blink Dagger is Zoo. Will only able to claim the Aegis straight off the bat. Stomp though catches three heroes on back right into Bone 7. 33 with another call in on top of three heroes. Messi will fall first. Zoo still looking strong, but no BKB just yet. No IO, no ball to keep him alive. So this is the point where TV should probably call it quits, especially with Kaipe already committing to the retreat. Being said though, Zoo almost looking. That's no really easy way for Viper to track down a vehicle like this. Getting all the new items, man. All the new items. Just need to get an Iron Tile now, just because. Because it's freaking OP. No? Okay. Yeah. Oh yeah, I heard about that. Yep. Yep. It shouldn't be happening. It's a ghost, right? It's not even something that you can counter. That's the biggest thing. Well, it's not like you can burst down a spur or some shit. It's completely invulnerable. Yeah. Well, anyway, bottom lane, who is this? This is Bone 7. If they can burst him down, maybe, but it hasn't worked before. They need some more lockdown. Oh, wow, we did get him. Yeah. And a perfect chain lockdown there. Zoo to start with. Cone with a follow up, and then just barely up. He was in the middle of the animation of the time lapse, but now with him being down, they'll claim a tier 2, and. Should they even be able to force out the buyback here? If they don't group up as much, then they aren't really as susceptible to 33 blinking in or storms or whatnot. They will have another creeper coming in. Oh, okay, they're going in deep here. The hookshot comes in, Pilar die, trying to come in on deep, but counterplay was there and the buyback's forced out. Now TBE find themselves inside the base. 33 looking for the call, finds on Zoo, the cast between him and Cat3X. BKB comes out, but the damage is still there on the physical side. They will lose their Tiny, and now the retreat has to be called. TBE have to scramble to get themselves out of their pwn, trying to do what he can to get the rest of the team time to move out. It's one TP, Cat3X will not be caught by the Bucks in the side, so doesn't have a TP scroll, unfortunately, so just gonna have to count on Kaipe not continuing to look for him. Yeah, pretty much. That could have turned out much worse for TBE here, but I don't know, I disagree with the decision to go in that deep. I mean, you know that Weaver probably has buyback. I mean, sieging down the tower, forcing that out, and then getting out, just retreating straight off the bat, would have been the way to go for me. Yeah. Oh, Cat3X! Does have a ghost scepter and falls up to the high ground. Do you still. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. Yeah. The eye is maybe just getting a little bit too big there. I mean, they have good sieging tools, right? I mean, especially for heroes down. Not just with Tiny, but also with Gedrox as well, right? He's sitting for a decent amount of right-click damage. And he has the range to actually do that safely with his own Hurricane Pike. Which is kind of a bigger part of that.
But yeah.
Smoke up. The rest of Kaipi going top. Bone 7. They do see him, I think. Yeah. This time up's available. They don't quite get the initial lockdown. Four stops galore. Gets off to the high ground with a Hurricane Pike. Now, time lapse back. The rest of Kaipi, no easy ways to get it close. Now, finally, do track him down. Cone and catches him in the arena of death. That's the dieback in him, too. 100 seconds down the drain. The only thing that.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's two lanes pushing in for Kaipi. Think TB is probably just gonna get to tier 2 and get out, or do they consider going high ground here?
Yeah.
Well, buyback on the biggest damage dealer here with the tiny in there. The retreat comes in, the hook shot, the arrow actually lands on the zoo, plus the stomp, two forces out with phone in frontline just creating chaos, sacrificing himself. Will get dunked, but the Rax, all that they need is tiny to hit him with kitted a couple of times. Changes to hit pilot die for a second as well, just to bring him down easily. And Suya's down a drain, Bambo. Four stuff in, Yules into Storm. Zoo actually misses the timing there. Sexy Bambo has the ghost stuff to keep himself alive for the time being. Sing Sing, well, he's dropping low as Cat3x and Gatrox is still very much alive. So is Zoo with another blink, another swipe to finish up the top range tracks. And they can easily go now for the bottom lane. They only lost Pwn during all of that. Nessie, I suppose, well, he's sitting at very, very low health points, just tanking 33 in Sing Sing's aggression, but I don't think they really care. Tiny's building damage is absolutely ridiculous. He needs like 3 or 4 hits to bring down a single building, a single Rax building. This will conclude the Magus, even if they all die here, which may happen here. Zoo just dropping very, very low. Gatrox and Cat3x at the same time, able to finish off the Axe. And yeah, it's no way to play against Mega Creeps at this point. Kaipi forced to call the GG 48 minutes into the game.